get your attention, please.
Yo, yo. You ready for this? Coming at you from Wicked Big Studios in Peabody, Massachusetts.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Sit back, buckle up, because you're in the happy hour with your boy,
What is up, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the happy hour. Good to have everybody here on a Tuesday night. I'll tell you what, guys, I am amped up, and it's good to have everybody back here on the happy hour King Hap podcast. Want to give a quick shout out real quick to, Beantown. Thank you very much, brother. If you guys see right now, if you guys are looking live, I have on one of the brand new Ring of Tees. And guys, should you want to get any of the swag delivered, you can get over to Beantown Bad Boy on Instagram, Happy Hour Social Club on Instagram, or the happyhoursocialclub.com. Also want to let everybody know we're being brought to you tonight by our friends at Recess. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, take a recess.com. Promo code King Hap is the number one mood altering drink, guys. When I tell you what, when you put up with the cast of characters I put up with, you are going to need to take a recess. Take a recess.com. Promo code King Hap. Lastly, guys, I want to let you know that we're being brought to you by our good friends at Old School Labs. Old School Labs, ladies and gentlemen, the official supplement provided to the Happy Hour Social Club. And I will tell you what, I cannot get enough of the protein, vintage brawn, vintage build, vintage burst. Right now, that's what I'm using as we rehab this ankle. Guys, it's coming along slowly but surely. But a big shout out, promo code King Apple, save you 15% site wide with all of our friends at Old School Labs. Guys, make sure you get the pump on. I'll tell you, this is going to be a great show tonight, and I'll tell you guys why. Number one, I'm excited for this show because, you know, this is something that definitely has me just fascinated, and I couldn't wait to get on the air. So I'm going to, without any further ado, if you guys don't know these gentlemen, they come to you from Narcos fame. If you guys watch Narcos on over on Netflix, number one, you're going to think, man, they should have picked some more handsome guys to play these two, because I'll tell you what, you guys definitely got them on the looks end. But I'll tell you, I want to give a quick shout out, guys, right away. Steve Murphy, thank you so much for being on the happy hour, brother. We appreciate you.
Hap, thanks for having us on the show, and tell us what's your address where we can send you money for all those nice comments.
I love it. I'll tell you, man. What's funny is we'll talk about your character on the show as we keep going, but we're going to talk even more. And I got to give a quick shout out to my man. If you see him right here to my side, Javier Pena, I'll tell you. Now, you guys right now, Javier, let me just ask you this. Number one, getting you guys here on the show is fantastic. I know the Happy Hour Social Club people, as you in the VIP chat right now, I'm so excited. This is fantastic. And, you know, Javi, I know you guys are swamped. You guys have been everywhere. But tell me this. I mean, you were in Colombia for quite some time. You spent time with the DEA. You're retired now. I mean, kid, do you actually get to sit back, Javier, and do one of these? How you feeling, big man?
Good. Yeah, appreciate it. It's going to be fun tonight. And yeah, you know what? I did 30 years, and now I'm having a lot of fun. I'm enjoying life. And you know what? Life is good, guys, right?
Yep. And I'll tell you guys, if you guys watch Narcos, I can tell you just from doing my research, I read the book. And guys, a lot of the things in Narcos are fairly close to what happened. But if you want the story told by the men who actually were there, and I'm talking they chased, captured, and killed Pablo friggin' Escobar down in beautiful Colombia. Guys, you want to get your hands on the book. It's called Manhunters, guys. And I'll tell you what, it is these two men right here co-authored it. How we took down Pablo Escobar by Steve Murphy and Javier Pena. The real story from the actual DEA agents portrayed in the hit Netflix series Narcos. Guys, let me ask you this. After all that, the show, because I know you guys will talk about it as we go, but you guys were consultants on the show. So let me ask you this. How long did it take you to actually put pen to paper and get this book written? I'll start with you, Steve. You tell me this. In this book here, how long did this take you to actually write?
Well, you know what, Hap, you're letting out our secrets here, brother. We employed a ghostwriter.
Of course.
We tried writing it ourselves, and it came out sounding like crap, so we thought we'd better do this the right way. The funny thing is, though, we kind of did this ass backwards in that they did the Narcos series, and then we wrote the book after the Narcos series was already out.
Of course.
It took, Isabel Vincent is our ghostwriter. Give her a shout-out. Super. She works for the New York Post there.
Great job.
Big Apple. Took a couple years. You know, she's busy writing other books, and she's an investigative reporter, but she did a fantastic job, and she's an excellent researcher.
Yep. And I'll tell you, Javier, tell me this, right? So first off, shout out from the chat room right there. I want to say thank you for 30 years of service. If you guys, I mean, I got the information right there. Javier, you were active in the DEA from 1976 to 2014. That is an amazing career. And I'll tell you what, man, let me just give you, I mean, wow. Congratulations, my man.
That is great. Yeah, just a little correction. I came on DEA in 84. Till 2014. I was with the sheriff's office in Laredo from 76 till 1984. Wow, I'm a little lost here today. So anyway.
Oh, yeah. Don't worry about it, man. That was quite some time ago. And Steve, yeah. I mean, hey, correct me if I'm wrong. I got the dates here from you, 1975 to 2013 yourself. Is that right?
Yeah, 12 years as a local cop and then 26 years with DEA.
So, and when the show starts off, they show you chasing down guys in flip-flops with marijuana. Is that legitimate? Is that how you started out?
No, that's part of that. That's part of that literary licensing that Netflix employed when they wrote the show Narcos. In 1976, I was a uniformed cop in Southern West Virginia. Never even been to Miami yet. So it's, I would have never chased anybody with marijuana anyway.
Right. it's really worth chasing people with marijuana. I mean, Pete's our bad boy in the chat room. Happy Hour Social Club VIP member wants to know if either one of you guys come from a family of law enforcement. How exactly did you walk down this? Now, I read the book, so I know the answers to these questions. But Javier, I'll start with you. How did you actually get involved in law enforcement?
Yeah, no, none of my family was law enforcement. You know, mine's a funny story, man. I was going to college. And I was working at the sheriff's office, and like a lot of us, I was working the night shift, go to school during the day. And I just, you know, sheriff's office back then, I was making, what, $10,000 a year, right? So I saw this bulletin on the bulletin board at the college says DEA is hiring. I did not know what DEA was about. So I had to ask a friend, hey, what the hell is DEA? The guy says, it's the federal narc, stupid. Oh, okay. But they were paying like $20,000 a year. So I applied. You know, I got selected, but never in my wildest dream. It was just a job opportunity. It was money, and that's all. And I said, you know what? I'm going to come on with DEA for a couple of years, and I'm going to go back to the sheriff's office. I was having fun. And you know what? Those 2 years after I joined the turning to 30, so I, you know, I liked it, and I saw the world with DEA. Yes.
And I'll tell you, you've seen a beautiful part of the world. Like I said, we'll get into that in a little bit, but I love me some Colombia. Everybody knows that. Medellin, my friends down in Comuna 13, et cetera. Steve, how exactly, what road did you travel down that brought you to the world of law enforcement? And before we knew it, to the fields of, you know, Colombia with 10 kilos of cocaine or whatever. I mean, geez, what brought you to these down this road?
You know, Hap, I wanted to be a cop since I was a little kid. Had my first run-in with the cops when I was about 10 years old, trying to break in the house. You know, the cops were back then could use discretion. They said, hey, boys, you got a decision to make. We can either put you in jail the rest of your lives or we can take you home to your parents. And we looked at each other and said, put us in jail, man. I don't want to go home and face that. So just wanted to be a cop, you know, my whole life. Started out in college in business. My dad was a retired minister and had a flooring store, and I had to start doing that when I was 14 years old and hated it then. I hate it now. That's manual labor. Got back to a local community, well, not a community college, but a local state college, and they had a criminal justice program. Took the test, scored number one on the test, joined the city police, and 19 years old, off and running, brother.
Love it, love it. And I'll tell you, man, you guys, I mean, DEA is one of the, you know, a lot of people look at it as kind of like a cush job. And I can't even say, like, the more that I studied, you know, because I, you know, from my trip to Colombia, I started studying more about the Pablo Escobar, you know, stuff, because I actually was kind of blown away when I went down there. And I want to ask you guys this, when you go down there, they almost try to erase the Pablo Escobar history from Colombia, from Medellin, et cetera. But it's like, even where he was killed is like, it was a real estate agency now. And it doesn't, you know, nothing at all that says Pablo Escobar or, you know, even just like, you'd think that if you own that place, you would go ahead and use it as a landmark. I mean, people would walk in to do business with you potentially just to see the location. But are you guys surprised? I'll start with Javier. Javier, are you surprised that a lot of the history of Medellin and the Pablo Escobar and the Medellin cartel has tried to be erased from the history of Colombia?
You know what? And I'm glad you brought up that is an excellent point. And I noticed that when we took the Netflix people down there, they wanted to go see, you know, where we lived, the famous search block, el bloque de búsqueda, the prison, the ranch house. You know what? And when I got to those places, it was like, I was like, why are they doing that? They're erasing history. They're trying to get rid of all the connotations associated with Pablo Escobar. And you are absolutely right. I was like, man, this is part of history. The search block, Bloque de Búsqueda in Medellin, it was right next to one of the poorest neighborhoods in Medellin. They demolished it. They got rid of where we used to sleep, where we used to operate from. Then we went to the prison, like the famous catedral, and they turned it into a monastery. When I was back then in 2015, I think. They got rid of all where he used to stay. The guy had a drinking pub inside the prison. They got rid of all that. It's like, and you're absolutely right, they're trying to get rid of that connotation, that history, which it blew my mind. It's like, wow, this is, I don't know. I didn't like it. I did not like it.
I don't either. And I'll tell you what, Steve, we could have, I mean, for a country that is as poor as Colombia is, something like Pablo Escobar's prison could have been an amazing place to have people come visit, come walk around, see what was going on there. I mean, think about it. I mean, Javier just said he had a bar in there. So why wouldn't you want to sit down at Pablo Escobar's bar and have a beverage, you know, a couple cervezas, you know, and just relax and be like, wow, take in the history. Look what happened. I mean, even restored. I mean, do you think this is crazy how that history is starting to disappear out in the beautiful, you know, country of Colombia?
Well, I don't like it. I agree with you guys, both of you guys. I don't like it either. But the fact is, I think the government would have been embarrassed if the public had gone in and saw what the prison really was, because it certainly wasn't a punitive environment. You know, it was a country club. I mean, they had... Pablo had a two-room suite with a jacuzzi bathtub. Here in the United States and most places in the world, they have what they call group showers when it comes to, you know, going to the bathroom. It was just ridiculous. I think there's a lot of embarrassment that went along with it. They just a couple years ago blew up the Monaco building there in Medellin, which is where the Escobar family lives. So it is, they are trying to erase that. And then you've got other people, you know, specifically his son, that are trying to, create these myths that are simply not true. But I mean, if you think about it, if my dad was Pablo Escobar, I might try to change that legacy as well, you know?
Yep. And I actually brought that up. It's funny, right before you guys jumped on and we were getting ready to start up, I brought it up with Ant and I said, his son, Pablo Escobar Jr., who has changed his name to Sebastian. I forgive me for trying to not being able to pronounce this Latin. I'm terrible with names, but Moroccan or something along these lines. But was that close, Javier?
Yeah, that's real close. Moroccan.
There we go. So Sebastian changed his name from Pablo Escobar Jr. pretty much to Sebastian. And now here's my question is like, so you see, sometimes he's out there apologizing for his father's sins. I mean, if you look at his Twitter page, it says the son of a legend. I mean, I'm trying to figure out what path he's going down, if he's apologetic for, his father's, sins, or if he's actually proud to be the son of, Pablo Escobar. I mean, do you pick up what I'm putting down here, Javier? Am I kind of losing my mind?
No, you're absolutely right. As a matter of fact, he's been doing shows all over the world. Steve and I, when we were when we were at our prime, we were in Europe, and he was always like ahead of us or behind us in another place. And one day his people reached out to us basically saying that he wanted to be on the same stage with us, and we absolutely said never. We will never be on the same stage with him. And there's another sicario named Popeye, who, after Pablo Escobar was killed, Popeye was the only living sicario that was left. John Jairo Velasquez is one of his main assassins. Anyway, the guy gets out of prison about 5 years ago, and he's got more talk shows. He was on all sorts of his own YouTube channel, Netflix. I mean, this guy, stone cold killer. I think he even admits to killing like 300 people. And they also wanted to put us on the same stage with him and said, we will never go up on the same stage. This guy's a stone cold killer, killed a lot of our police officer friends. Why would we want to give him that? But anyway, he recently died about a year ago. So they're just trying to, like I said, make money off of that myth.
And one of the questions here, and I want to throw this, I'll throw this to both of you guys here. One of the Happy Hour Social Club VIP insiders here. We got Batista 610 wants to know if either one of you have ever met Griselda Blanco, and is that who put Escobar to work? Can that be confirmed by either one of these gentlemen? I'm wondering, is this who essentially put Pablo Escobar to work as the drug kingpin of the world at one point?
Well, you know what? Pablo Escobar employed her to run his Miami market. So she worked for Pablo Escobar, and she was just as ruthless, maybe more ruthless than some of Sicario. She herself, our intelligence, she killed, I don't know, 20, 30 people herself. She was a very ruthless lady. Anyway, and you know the story, right? She gets out of prison and she goes back to Medellin, 2012, if I'm not mistaken. And she's having a big party, welcome home party, buying beer, meat, big party, comes out of the market. What happens? Two guys on the motorcycle, the guy in the back shoots her. They kill Griselda Blanco. And that was one of their tactics that they were in Medellin. One of the most famous ways of killing people are two guys on a motorcycle. Yeah. The guy in the back shoots, they get out of traffic, they never get caught. And that's how Griselda Blanco ended her life, with two guys on a motorcycle. The bad guy shoots her. Yeah.
Yep. Our good friend Danny from the Real Colombia, Colombian tour guide, and I'll tell you, a good friend of the show. I mean, we spent a ton of time with him showing us around. He actually told us on these mopeds, these people would drive by someone hanging off the back, automatic weapon, blow some people away, and then they can get on the sidewalk and be out. Now, I got a million questions here, and I mean, they keep coming in here from hated her for killing his father. Yep, I'm reading here, but the chat room is going on fire. They love you guys, guy, and I appreciate you being here. So, Steve, let me ask you this. Now, this is basically, if you said I could only ask you guys one question, this is what I would want to know. When the public of Medellin and all the rest of Colombia, but mostly Medellin, which is I find to be kind of where Pablo did most of his work, I feel like, and in the commune, mm-hmm. etc. But the public there, now this is one of the most poor countries, and what people don't know is Pablo Escobar kind of tried to take on like, I will call it like a Robin Hood or something along those lines type role, where he would make all this crazy money, and I mean, $500 million a week, $80 million a day reported at one point. But he would go out with stacks of money and just hand this out to people, basically to have people get his back. Now, when you guys are going out there and you're trying to take down Pablo Escobar, how does the public react to the search block, to everybody? Is it a mixed bag? Or do they come out there and are they like, you know, like, screw you? I know they called you guys the gringos, but is it like, screw you guys for like trying to go after Pablo, who's giving them the money? Or were they secretly like, take this MF-er down so we can go ahead and move on with our lives? I mean, I'll start with you, Steve. What do you think the public thought of you guys while you were there?
Well, it depended on where you were. You know, if you went into the communas, especially the barrio Pablo Escobar, you know, they think he walks on water. You know, they look at him as a god. And it is true that he built clinics, he built housing for people that were extremely poor. He gave away money, he gave away food, he built soccer fields, and all that's good stuff. But when he needed to hire new sicarios, where do you think he went to recruit them?
Oh, yeah.
He went right back into that neighborhood. So rather than being a Robin Hood, we refer to him as a master manipulator, because he manipulated those people into thinking that, you know, I mean, these young kids, these teenagers were willing to kill for Pablo. They're willing to die for Pablo, really not knowing what's going on. You know, he put a bounty on Colombian national police officers of $100 a head to go up and shoot a cop, kill the cop, make $100. I mean, you know, a person's life is worth $100. But then if you look on down the road after his escape from prison, when Los Pepes came along, now Los Pepes is just, it's a group of vigilantes, which we don't condone in law enforcement, but they were just as dangerous and as ruthless as Pablo. But the truth is they used Pablo's tactics against him. And initially public opinion was in favor. It's like, hey, Pablo's getting a dose of his own medicine now. But then they killed a couple of attorneys, which, you know, wasn't necessarily a bad thing, but one of them had his kid with him, 10-year-old kid, and they killed the kid. So now in Colombia, where we would not publish that in a newspaper or on the TV here in the United States, they do down there. Yep. So when that came out in the media, you know, public opinion started to turn away from Los Pepes, not that it was pro Pablo, but wanting the government, you know, I just forgot the president's name. Cesar Gaviria. Thank you. You know, wanting him, and his platform was he was going to bring back extradition and stop the violence. Well, stop the violence. Well, you know what? It did stop on December 2nd, 1993, when Pablo was killed.
Yep. And you know, a lot of people say that, you know, it was one of the best things that happened there, but some of the people down there, they don't think the search block was, you know, they think that it was corrupt. And people like the assassination of the gentleman's name? It escapes me right now. I'm sorry. But yeah, I'll get back to that in one second. When they killed Ramirez, no. Hugo Ramirez, right? Who's played, he has a different name in the show. But right. When they killed him in the show, they actually glorify it that Pablo went up and killed him. That actually, Javier, is not the case, correct? Pablo Escobar didn't kill him himself. Is that right?
No, Sicarios killed him, and he was killed because that colonel did a lot of damage on Pablo Escobar, seized a lot of his cocaine labs. Yeah, and also on that Robin Hood topic, also I got to mention, man, you know who always, you know, who also had a big effect was a Catholic church in Medellin. I hate to mention it, you know, and I'm Catholic, man, you know, so I'm not anti-Catholic, but there was a priest, Father Rafael Garcia Herreros, who used to come out on TV every afternoon saying Pablo was a good person, just a little misunderstood. So you can imagine the Catholic church in favor of Pablo Escobar. Why? Because all the money he was giving to the church, building churches, giving tons of money. And, you know, like you said, we could talk, you know, but, you know, Pablo Escobar, I mean, what, put a bomb on a commercial airline, right? Killed 107 people. We could talk all, you know, all night about all the atrocities he did. But it was just amazing to me that the Catholic Church in Medellin used to come out and say Pablo was basically a good person.
So basically it was split down the middle. The poorer neighborhoods really liked him, as it says right here. The government completely ignoring the plight of people. Escobar came in and built 1,000 new houses, a soccer field, etc. He felt the connection to the poor and the pot, and he went ahead and ran for Congress. Now, well, you guys were already there when he ran for Congress, is this correct? Or you guys were already starting the investigation when he was running for Congress, is that correct? Or am I mistaken?
No, he ran for before us, before I get there, before Steve gets there. He ran for Congress and he was ousted. They found out one of the congressmen, as a matter of fact, one of the main guys was a presidential candidate who was assassinated by Pablo Escobar, Luis Carlos Galan. Congress, they found out, so they had him ousted, and Pablo Escobar never forgot that. So that was before our time.
So now I want to ask about that, because that's something that I got to touch on. You guys obviously touch on in the book, and we ain't going to give away the whole book here, guys. So you guys got to make sure you get over to Amazon, Audible. I'm going to tell you the truth, guys. Audible, I think, is the best place to get this book, because hearing them read it like from you guys' mouth, it really is like you're there. So basically, it's like getting the whole Narco series, but right from the source, guys. Audible.com. Get on over there. We'll put that in. Thank you very much. It's up in the VIP chat room, that link, guys. Feel free. Go ahead, give that a click and listen and enjoy. Now, one of the things here I was going to ask is, when you talk about extradition to the U.S., now here's my question. Why in God's name did they continue with this, knowing that Pablo Escobar was so like dead set against it and was going to continue to be vicious? And like he's, I believe the quote is, a tomb in Colombia is better than a jail cell in the United States, if I'm not mistaken. Is that the proper quote, Javier?
Yeah, that is perfect. Prefiero una tumba en Colombia que un calabozo en Estados Unidos. You translated it perfect. I prefer a tomb in Colombia than a jail cell in the United States.
And why now? Let me ask you this. The man builds his own jail. And now this, and I, hey, call me contrarian here. The man builds his own jail away from everybody, right? And we know this turned out to be more of a country club, but he built his own jail, locked himself and a lot of his associates in this prison where they were out of the streets of Medellin. And if he came out and stayed out of the narcotics game, he would have come out to billions of dollars and could have been done whatever the hell he wanted, etc. Why didn't they just allow him to serve out his prison term, which I don't recall what it was. I believe it was a substantial prison term. 5 years? Oh, I thought it was 15 years. I apologize. 5 years. He could have done that standing on his head in that place. But my question is, when they did that, why did they continue to press? And why did the government and everybody, when they were supposed to stay miles away, why did they go up and actually go in there now? I want to start with Steve, because Steve, I think you were front lines on that one, if I'm not mistaken, right? You had a lot to do with them going up to visit Mr. Escobar in his prison, correct?
Well, not directly, indirectly. We, Javier and I had an informant who told us what went on up there.
Yep.
So, you know, the whole year he was there, we couldn't intercept any communications. And that's one of our fortes. That's one of the things we're really good at. So the informant comes out and explained to us that two of Escobar's associates, Kiko Moncada and Fernando Galeano, Pablo called them up to the prison because his sicarios had found, we've heard anywhere from $10 to $23 million in U.S. cash that had been shrink wrapped and hidden in a cave or underground, and the seal had released itself, and so you had moisture and air getting in there, and this money was rotting away. So, according to the informant, Pablo killed one of his best friends, Kiko Moncada. They were childhood friends, and then Sicarios killed Fernando Galeano. So, you know, here's a guy who, first of all, has the deal of a lifetime. You know, by pleading guilty to one crime that he got to pick, he was absolved of every other crime he committed in his life, including thousands and thousands of murders. Popeye is, you know, the Sicario that died a few years ago from cancer. In a documentary that we're all on, he says that Pablo is responsible for killing as many as 50,000 people. And he's absolved of all those murders. So now he's continuing rather than just doing his time, like you said, on his head and come out 5 years and enjoy life. He murdered two more people up there. That's just the ones we know about. I mean, he didn't stop his drug trafficking. He didn't stop the violence. I will say, though, that 1 year he was in prison, the car bombs in Colombia did stop. So there was that level of peace.
Yep.
Where people weren't too afraid of a car, you know, just being in the wrong place at the wrong time, and a car bomb goes off and you get killed or you get maimed. But if you're going to let him murder people when he wants to, where he wants to, then why have the rule of law to start with?
Yeah, understood. And, you know, it's Colombia's a tough, I can understand that Colombia is a tough place to police, especially with the shortage of money. And, you know, when you have the type of money like this, I mean, we're talking $500 million a week to go ahead. Something tells me police officers in the U.S., let alone Colombia, aren't making that kind of money. And they have the ability to pay off pretty much the entire police force, which we're going to get into. We're going to take a brief break, guys. We're going to come back. Javier Pena, Steve Murphy. Guys, we're going to take this brief break. We got a quick commercial break, and then we're right back. Do me a favor, guys. Make sure you stick around. Keep the awesome questions coming in the VIP chat room. We love you all. We'll be right back after this very brief message. Stick around.
Get your top, Mr. Leg.
Guys, today's episode of the Happy Hour is brought to you by Liquid IV. Liquid IV is the world's greatest hydration drink, and the best part is, it's good for you. Liquid IV is taking care of the Happy Hour Social Club members with 25% off. Guys, that is a great deal. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 25%. They have great all-new flavors like guava, apple pie, watermelon, pina colada, strawberry, and the new Happy Hour-inspired tangerine. All these flavors are refreshing and delicious. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 25%. And speaking of refreshing and delicious, back to your host of the Happy Hour, King Hap.
Yeah. The lovely ladies of the Happy Hour. bringing you good looks and great deals, ladies and gentlemen. Liquid IV, one of my very favorite sponsors. Should you have too much to drink tonight, make sure tomorrow you wash away your hangover, a little bit of Liquid IV. I'll tell you what, guys, if you're out there working out, getting your workout on, promo code KINGHAP will save you 25% site-wide. Tomorrow, ladies and gentlemen, I am giving you a drop here. My friends over at Liquid IV are going to give me a kick in the behind for this one. Tomorrow, we have a new energizing multiplier drop, and it is YUZU Pineapple. Will be out tomorrow morning, guys. This has, I mean, hey, we're giving you the break here. You know, hey, when you get lucky enough to be sponsored by Liquid IV, you get this a little bit early, so I'm going to let you guys know. Get to the site tomorrow should you want to get the Pineapple Energizing Liquid IV. Promo code KINGHAP saves you 25%. Boom. We are back. I'm having too much fun tonight, guys, I'll tell you. But, I mean, hey, Steve, I'm going to leave you out of this question because I ain't going to get you in any trouble because I know that you were involved. So, Javier, do me a favor. I want to go ahead because I've told everybody here who listens to the show. I can tell you Beantown has as well. The bottom line is, how beautiful are the women in Colombia, Javier? Tell me this.
You know what? Very, very beautiful. It is. I mean, in every, like, you know, Bogota, Cali, Medellin, they all have distinctive features. But it was just, and you know what? The women from Medellin, they're called paisas, you know, paisa, you know, it's a, like a nickname. Bogota was cachaca. I don't remember what, caleñas. But anyway, they're all, you know, and as you, you've been there to Medellin, it's more of the light skin, right? But, you know, Bogota, you got that, you know, the beautiful women, you know, Sofia Vergara, right? comes from Colombia. Look how beautiful she is. So, yes, they are extremely beautiful, but also they're good people. You know what I'm saying? Good souls, beautiful. They'll treat you. They'll, you know what I'm saying? They're very accommodating.
Some of the people I met in Colombia are some of the best people I know to this day. I can tell you that, guys. And I mean, you guys had the privilege of staying down there. But one of the things I was going to say, and Steve, I'll throw this one over to you. How many times would you think you left, say, you know, the embassy or you left your apartment? I mean, how many times would you say you did that and you actually thought your life was at risk?
It was only 3 years.
So only 3 years every day.
Wow. I mean, you can see me half. I'm about as white as you get. I'm come from an English Irish background. I don't blend in a Hispanic country. I kind of stick out. I got light colored eyes. I'm 6'2". You know, I used to have brown. I used to have hair. But you know, everywhere you went, people stared at you.
It's funny because it says here in the chat room, somebody asked, I mean, no disrespect, but how does a man, a fair-skinned man like you, not stick out like a sore thumb in Colombia? I didn't ask that question, but you kind of just answered it for me, bro, right?
Yeah, no, the truth is the truth. And you know, I mean, you just, the first time my wife and I, we went in the Unicentro Mall, which is the biggest mall in Bogota, it used to be. Love it. And I'm walking down the hallway and people are just stopping, staring at me. And I'm thinking, is my zipper open? You know, do I have some broccoli in my teeth or, you know, it makes you very self-conscious, but you know, you get used to it. You get complacent with it and you just deal with it.
Yep. I was, it's funny. I was filming a commercial for BioAccelerator when we were down there and I'm walking around and people are like, oh my goodness, who's this guy? He must be a super duper celebrity. And I'm like, you know, it's just kidding.
Well, you are. Everybody's heard a Hap. Come on, man.
I love it, man. Thank you. I appreciate that. But tell me this, Javier, how many times how often would you say you felt your life was actually in danger when you were outside of the embassy or you were outside of your apartment? I know your first apartment, unfortunately, you had to leave. That was gorgeous, yeah. Correct?
Yeah, that was gorgeous apartment overlooking the mountains of Bogota, then the city view, 17th floor. I always remember, like, my living room was all glass, you know, beautiful. But yeah, I get a call from my boss, says, Javier, he says, all right, don't panic, just get your keys. We used to drive Broncos back then. He says, get your gun and get out of your apartment ASAP. Get out immediately. We'll tell you what's going on, but just get out of there. Basically, once I got to the embassy, they were waiting for me. They told me that there were some sicarios. They intercepted some, telephone interceptions where they were coming to come and get me. So I left right away. Yep. So, yeah. And when we were in Medellin, one of the things, and, you know, I got to mention is the Medellin cops, who worked with us. They took care of us. There, you know, we lived at the search block. It was called el bloque de búsqueda. It's a famous term now in Colombia, el bloque de búsqueda. And you're right. There's a lot of people that think that, you know, our cops were playing dirty, going after Escobar, you know, all the accusations, which is not true. But, you know, we stayed there and we had selected, handpicked these guys. So they knew us, we knew them, we took care of them, they took care of us. So that's one of the reasons we're always secure, because we're always with them. But, and I just got to mention, you know, my biggest fear were the car bombs. You know, we're talking about Pablo Escobar. As soon as, like I said, and you hit it. Wow, you've done some great research there, buddy. You know, it's all about extradition. Pablo did not want to get extradited to the United States. That was his war. That was the war that, you know, it was based on. Extradition. He did not want to get extradited. So in Colombia at this time, I mean, we can, you know, talk about it here in a little bit, but you know, the when you started placing the car bombs, it was 10 to 15 a daily basis, restaurants, shopping centers, at malls, right outside our school when we leave the convoys. A lot of cops lost their lives because of the, you know, those deadly car bombs. A lot of civilians, a lot of citizens just being at the wrong place at the wrong time were killed because of Pablo Escobar's car bombs. Can you imagine 10 to 15 on a daily basis? And then you know what? Then he would put those leaflets where you mentioned it was called the extraditables. And the saying was, prefiero una tumba en Colombia de un calabozo en, you know, in Estados Unidos. Basically, that was his calling card. So he was taking credit for killing as many people as possible.
I got some fantastic questions from the VIP chat room. I'm going to throw a couple at you guys real quick, if you don't mind. Steve, did you have to learn Spanish by default? That's a good question. I want to know, did you end up learning fluent Spanish?
You know, they sent me to language school for 6 months in D.C. Here's the problem. They taught me how to speak proper Spanish. Hell, I don't speak proper English.
You don't tell me.
You know, with my accent, I'd walk in a room and I'd say, hola, y'all. And they didn't understand me. I didn't understand that. So, but actually what happened is when I got to Colombia, that first week is when Escobar surrendered to his prison. So that gave me about a year to work with Javier and his other partner, Gary Sheridan, and get to learn the background of the case and the intricacies and all that. But I was also taking additional classes, Spanish classes from a Colombian. Yep. And then when we moved up to Medellin after Pablo escaped, that's when, you know, the cops and the military folks that we worked with were outstanding. If we weren't out on operations, a couple of them would grab me and they're like, come on, let's go get a cup of coffee or go get a beer. And, you know, and we'd sit there and they would teach me local dialects, local sayings, all that kind of stuff. So I'll never be as fluent as Javier was. And actually, when I speak Spanish, I can kind of get rid of my country accent a little bit. So they did understand me.
That's funny, because I wouldn't think your accent would go away. I know mine doesn't. I'm, you know, even when I try to talk a little bit of Spanish, which I know none of, I'm terrible. So I failed Spanish, if you guys can't tell. I can, like you said, I can barely speak English. So I'll stick to learning English first, then we'll move on to Spanish. But here's a good one. Previous guests who've been on the show have touched on Pablo. They've said less force of violence, more force of business decisions and bribery. Would you two agree?
I didn't understand the question. Go ahead.
So going after him was more a business decision, less a force of violence, more of a force of a business decision and bribery. So basically, this was a business decision with the whole, you know, in Medellin, you know, the cartels taking him, the Cali cartel going after him, etc. This was a business decision with other, you know, trying to take him down was a business decision from other gangs, etc., and even from the internal police departments. I mean, would you say that, or would you say this was due to the violence?
Well, if from the government standpoint, especially the police, it was due to the violence. Okay. They were over this one case. Now, think about this, app. One investigation, one case, over 1,000 police officers killed in one case. I mean, when a cop gets killed here, I mean, up until just a few years ago, when a cop was killed, that was a big thing here. When one cop was killed, huge. Now not so much, because it's just the change of whatever.
Yeah,
that's another discussion. So, but if you're looking at it from the other narcotics standpoints, the Cali cartel, the North Valley cartel, the other mom and pops out there, they wanted Pablo out of the way. So that was a business decision. but it's so that they can increase their illegal profits.
Yeah.
So it just depends on where you stood on the playing field as to what the motivation was to take him out. I mean, shit, he was the, excuse my language here. He's the he was the world's most wanted criminal. He's the world's first narco terrorist. He developed a business plan of narcotics trafficking that made him responsible for as much as 80% of the world's cocaine. Wouldn't you like to have 80% of the podcast market have? Oh, I mean, you goodness. Probably do already, but you'd be saying Joe Rogan. Who the hell's that, right?
Who's Joe Rogan? I appreciate that. But you're right. 80% of the world's cocaine is what he was pumping out. And like I said, we're talking a half a billion dollars a week. This is, I mean, you want to talk about business 101. To make a kilo of cocaine, if I'm not mistaken, and this is just from hearing it from Steve's mouth, I could be wrong. To make a kilo of cocaine would be about $1,000 US. Is that right, Steve?
Right. And then you got your transportation fee to get it to wherever you're going. In the United States, back in the day, it was roughly $3,000 to $4,000 per kilo. So $5,000 is your initial investment per kilogram. And you know, back in the early 80s, that kilo of coke might go for $60,000 to $80,000 in Miami.
Damn, that is a hell of an investment. I mean, you show me something where I can get involved, where I can make that kind of profit. I mean, not cocaine, fellas. I mean, I don't need you to look
at the
West Peabody match. You know what I'm saying?
We may have to have a talk afterwards here.
I'm saying Javier will be here with his girlfriend's kicking in the door. I'm like, oh, guys, I was just kidding. This is an excellent question, and I actually am excited to hear the answer to this. Shout out for this question, guys. Some people say, Javier, the explosion that left Manuela Escobar half deaf, right? I guess she's deaf in her left ear, was a an ad popped up, of course. They say was the Cali cartel's responsibility. Others have said that this was the responsibility of the search bloc combating the Medellin cartel. Who actually was responsible for the explosion that left this woman half deaf?
Without a doubt, it was a Cali cartel. We found out about it. And let me just real brief. Cali cartel, we alluded to, hated Pablo. Pablo hated the Cali cartel. And it all stemmed from the turf wars. Cali cartel's forte was New York. Pablo was trying to infiltrate their market. Pablo's forte was Miami, all that Florida area. And they had a deadly war going on for about 10 years. Cali cartel was trying to kill Pablo. It got to the point where they placed a car bomb at the building called Monaco, trying to kill Pablo and his family. The only one that was hurt was his daughter, Manuela, and you're absolutely right. She's pretty much deaf in one ear. She was a little kid. So you can imagine Pablo Escobar hatred towards the Cali. They just tried to kill his family and his little girl. I mean, obviously, you know, like any father, that was his princess. So Pablo retaliated. And I remember it was at a soccer game. A lot of Cali people were playing soccer. Pablo Sicarios wiped them out. And then there's another accurate story that's out there, which is true, is Cali cartel hired some British mercenaries to go kill Pablo. Wow. They had choppers, they had about 20 guys, all trained, all mercenary type people. However, they had to abort the mission. One of the choppers crashed, but they were en route to go kill Pablo Escobar. So the hatred was there, but it wasn't the search bloc. The search bloc got accused a lot of atrocity. It was the Cali cartel, without a doubt, that put that bomb in front of the Monaco building.
Yeah. I actually, you know, what's funny is I read, when you read online, you read a lot of things, you know, the U.S. police and this came from the DEA and all this. So I was wondering about that because Manuela, actually, I read online also, she's on tough times right now. She tried an attempt on her own life, et cetera. Yeah. You know, hey, we wish her the best. Hopefully everything goes right.
And you know what? I met her. And I'll always remember she was about 5 or 6 years old, just at the airport in Medellin. They were flying to Miami, of all places. I had U.S. visas. I happened to be there. I called the ambassador. He says, Javier, tear their visas. They cannot come to the U.S. If they want to come get a visa, tell them to come into the embassy. We'll talk to them there. Obviously, that didn't happen. But anyway, so we did not let them travel. And in all the chaos, the people's crying, screaming, running, it was a mess. I always remember her. She just sat down and she had a white little puppy, and just started playing with the puppy, talking to the pup, you know, to the little dog. So you can imagine, and you're right, I've heard she's, I mean, obviously you go through all that killing, who's going to be right, you know, in there.
Scary.
Yeah, scary, but yeah.
Scary to think. And another fantastic question. Now, Steve, were you guys there strictly for Pablo Escobar, looking just for Pablo Escobar, or were you down there to take down even all the cocaine trafficking from Colombia, or is it just Pablo Escobar the search block was for?
It was just take out Pablo. It was, we had enough DEA agents in the embassy that, you know, we had a couple of agents assigned to the Cali cartel, a couple guys, jungle lab ops, a couple guys, diversion or precursor chemicals, intelligence, all that. And so Javier and I were just assigned specifically to the Medellin cartel. And then when he escaped from his prison, the next day, Javier and I flew to Medellin, and that's when we started living there for the next 18 months, working just with the search block. And you know what? The police told us, they said, this is not about seizing dope. It's not about seizing money. It's about taking down Pablo Escobar and the entire Medellin cartel. And that's exactly what they did.
Yep. And the Colombian government kind of turned a blind eye to some of the Cali cartel people, from what I've been led to believe, because they were also searching for Pablo Escobar, Javier. Is that correct? And I mean, when you were there, did you know that this, I mean, you knew this was going on, correct?
And you are correct in that the Cali cartel was trying to take down Pablo Escobar. And you know what? I'll give you a great example. The first Medellin cartel, pretty much equivalent to Pablo Escobar, was a guy by the name of Jose Gonzalo Rodriguez Gacha, el Mexicano. Mm-hmm. And the informant we employed, and he was responsible for taking down, you know, I mean, it was the cops who took him down, but the informant led us to Gacha. And Gacha was Pablo's partner, probably richer than Pablo Escobar.
Really?
Yep. And so when he gets killed, the informant, we're going to pay him, I think it was like $1 million, because that was a reward on Gacha. And the money took a while. So the informant one day got all pissed at us and said, you know what, guys, tell the U.S. they can keep their money. I've already made $1 million from the Cali cartel. So the Cali cartel had hired him to infiltrate Pablo and work with us. And wow. No, we did not know that. What that, you know, that was about. So we didn't pay him, obviously, because, you know, we don't work with other terrorist organizations. But Cali cartel was doing all sorts of stuff. They were the ones who financed the famous vigilante group called Los Pepes. Steve talked about them. Yep. Cali cartel was the one who financed them. We did not know that. Afterwards, after Pablo Escobar gets killed, a guy by the name of Don Berna was the actual leader of Los Pepes. And he was always at our search block, not unbeknownst to us that he was being paid by Cali cartel. So it basically, he gets extradited to the United States after Pablo Escobar gets killed because he becomes one of the biggest traffickers.
And I'll tell you, it's like when you think about how vicious the Los Pepes was. I mean, seeing that, knowing that they were going so crazy looking for Pablo because they were getting paid by Cali cartel, was making almost as much money as Pablo Escobar was. I mean, guys, just so everybody listening knows, Pablo Escobar was actually listed as number 7 on the Forbes most wealthy people in the world list. Number friggin' 7. Holy cash. And I'll tell you what, if you put me in a prison, especially as a jacuzzi bathtub for 5 years, and I can come out and keep all that money, I'll tell you the last thing I'm doing is selling any kind of narcotics or messing with you two. You know what I'm saying? I mean, hey, you can keep all, I'll tell you where my cocaine is and where my money's buried. I'm going to keep this money I got right here and move forward with it. I got one here, just a little scoop for you guys. I wonder if you guys heard anything about this. And I want to ask you, Steve, if you think this would fly, but I have something here that happened Thursday, September 24th, 2020. It was reported that Nicholas Escobar claims Vision helped him discover money hidden by his infamous uncle in one of his apartments. Now, they're saying he found $18 million of Pablo Escobar's money in an apartment. Number one, do you think this is accurate? And number two, would the government of Colombia actually let this fly, you think?
Yeah, no, I don't believe it at all. I mean, you can recognize Lewis when he comes walking down the streets. He's got a big L tattoo on his forehead. And if you did find that, would you report it
right,
so that the government could come after you? It makes absolutely no sense. You know, just, and that's what we say to people, just apply the common sense principle and see if it makes common sense to you. It absolutely does not.
Imagine going, first off, imagine if you found $18 million. Then imagine you're in Colombia. You're going to tell people you got $18 million in cash. Something tells me, number one, you ain't playing with a full deck. Or number two, you're lying through your teeth. I mean, what do you think, Javier? Am I crazy? Yeah.
No, that's not true. Of course, he would come out. And Nicholas Escobar, we know him. He was, Pablo was his uncle. And, you know, there's all sorts of rumors out there, but they never would report it. And also, if you report it, that imagine all the other traffickers, all the other criminals were going to be coming after you to get that money. So
that would never have
happened. Right.
I'll tell you though, I mean, a lot of the Escobar family has gone ahead and tried to make money off of, you know, the dad's legacy. One of the questions that I have now, and you guys were, directly involved with this, the protection that his daughter and wife and mother were put under, that they went ahead and they went to go ahead and end the protection. Now, my question is this something that was a strategy move to get Pablo to come out? I mean, when they, you know, setting Pablo's wife and daughter free from the, you know, police protection at that point, and you wouldn't let them travel out of the country. Now, like as you said about their visas, Javier, was this a strategic ploy to go ahead and get Pablo to come out of hiding?
Yes, it was. It was basically, we knew, like I said, you know, when we stopped them from going to Medellin, they came back, they regrouped, and they went to Frankfurt, Germany. So at this time, we found out, and the Colombia Attorney General at this time, a guy by the name of Gustavo de Grave, he wanted to run for president. So he protected the family. And we wanted that because it was giving us another chance at getting Pablo Escobar. So when the family goes to Frankfurt, Germany, the German authorities, Colombian authorities, U.S. authorities all have a big meeting. And you know what? Half of the Germans wanted them to stay there, that give them, you know, protection. The other half says, no, get him out of here. So luckily the half kicked them out, which is what we wanted. And towards the end, it was, we were following the family, and we were obviously, you know, they're intercepting their phone calls. And so we wanted the family back, yes, because it was a ploy. And we did it intentionally because that was another ploy for us to actually find Pablo Escobar. And you know what? That's how he was found towards the end. Pablo was talking to his son, Juan Pablo, and that's where the famous interception came in. And, you know, I mean, if you want to get into it in a little bit, you know, how he was finally, you know, killed.
And of course, I'm going to touch on that. But you know what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to take a quick commercial break because I got some questions I'm going to ask you guys. We got the quickest commercial break of the day. We're coming back because I got to bring it up. You see me on, guys, if you go over on Instagram, you see King.Hap on Instagram. You see me on there going ahead, posing right underneath with Beantown Bad Boy and the CES heavyweight champ, Big John Johnston, right at the spot of Pablo Escobar's death. Now, I'm going to tell you, Wikipedia says that the person that is, let me see here. How's this? The person that is credited with killing Pablo Escobar is one Steve Murphy. Ladies and gentlemen, we are going to talk about this when we come back right after this brief message. Yes, that was a cliffhanger on purpose, and we will talk to you right after this. Stick around.
Hey guys, tonight's episode of the Happy Hour is brought to you by Chili Sleep Technology. Chili Sleep Systems is a game changer. Chili's Cool Mesh Pad is the most luxurious sleep system in the industry and is also hydro-powered. This can warm you up on those cold winter evenings or cool you off during a steamy summer night. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 22% off an entire sleep system. This is certainly a purchase that you will not regret. Our systems can bring the temperature anywhere from 55 degrees to 115 by remote control or the Chili Sleep app. Get over to chilitechnology.com and make sure to use promo code KINGHAP to save 22%. And now, back to a man that needs absolutely no help warming it up in between the sheets, your host of the Happy Hour, King Hap.
Oh, yeah. the lovely ladies of the happy hour. Guys, I'm proud to let you guys know that ChiliSleep.com has increased your discount for being a happy hour social club member from 22% to 30%. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the number one discount ChiliSleep gives you. ChiliSleep.com, promo code KINGHAP. Like they say, you don't need any help warming it up in between the sheets. Javier, I heard a rumor too about you. You didn't need no help warming it up in between the sheets down there in Colombia. I don't know. Steve gave me the nod when I said it. I don't know, brother. So I won't make you say it here in front of the millions of happy hour listeners, but I know you had a good time down there in Colombia, correct?
Yeah, of course I did.
I love it.
Let me just say, Hap, that man right there is a man slut. I love it.
Hey, you know what? I told people I wish all that stuff was true. That's on the Narcos series. I wish it would have been true.
I told you when I see Pedro Pascal played you, I said they couldn't have found someone more handsome. I mean, geez, look at this guy, Netflix, the hell you doing? But I'll tell you guys. So, I mean, first off, I love having you guys here. It's awesome. The chat room's going crazy, crazy here. So I'm gonna ask that big question in just 1 second, talk about the little location here at the real estate agency down there in Colombia. But before I get to there, I got a good question here in the chat room. And Steve, you tell me this, man. What would you say is the stickiest situation you found yourself in Colombia when you were down there, part of the search block, or even just before that, etc.?
You know, what scared me the most was we would go out on the Huey gunships with the Colombian National Police on raids. And, you know, you can hear especially if you're in the mountains raiding these ranches, you can hear us 5 minutes before we get there. So that gives the people on the ground time to prepare for your landing. So for me, that was always the hairiest thing. I mean, I'd love to tell you I was never scared down there. The truth is I was scared every day. But that scaredness is what keeps you alive as long as you can maintain it, you can control it. Because if you let it overtake you, you're going to get killed.
Absolutely. And you know what? It keeps you aware. And I'll tell you, when I first got to Colombia, and I've talked about Colombia at length on the show before, but I'll tell you, I was worried when I got there. I knew I was going there for a specific reason. I was staying in a really nice place, but I was like, I got to get out and see this place. And one of the things I was worried about is exactly, you know, because I heard Pablo Escobar, the cartel, this, that, the other thing, you know, dirt poor, et cetera. And one of the things I found amazing in Communa 13 was the step system, where the more wealthy you are, the lower you are on the steps, and the poorer you are, you got to climb more steps to get to your house. So if you're carrying your groceries coming home from work, et cetera, you can either, you know, you can take that gondola ride there, or you got to scale those steps. I'll tell you, man, Colombia is an excellent place. And, you know, I don't look at it as a third world country or anything like that, but there is a lot of crazy stuff going on down there. Javier, would you say, I mean, what would you say is the stickiest situation you might have gotten yourself into?
Well, and for me, it was different. The stickiest, and I'll be honest, you know what? It was dealing with the spooks, with our own agency, the CIA. I had more problems with those guys, and it was all jealousy type shit. You know what? I respect them now, later on, but it was just over turf war, dealing with the guys. Those guys threatened to arrest me at one point. I mean, because I'm helping Colonel Martinez, and they get all pissed off, and oh man, it was just, you know, I didn't know what to do. I was like, what the hell am I getting into here? Our own agency. Later on, like I said, you know, it changed, and it was just over turf, you know, over we were in charge. They were not in charge. But anyway, it was dealing with our own agencies, the most stickiest problem. You know, imagine, say, oh, we're going to arrest you. Like, oh, come, I know better now. But you know what? It was just all part of the jealousy shit, you know.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, that must have got you going in the head. I mean, Steve, you must have felt the same way, right, big man?
Well, I thought he was going to say he was worried about a girl's husband coming home while he was there, but right. that went a different direction.
Just saying, you were being Top Bad Boy's favorite participant in the show, Narcos. He thought that you were the gentleman who played you was hysterical. Little did he know that that was exactly how you acted, right, Steve? That was probably into a T, right?
You know, we got to meet both of the actors before they started filming, and yep. Have stayed in contact with them. And just two super guys, Boyd Holbrook and Pedro Pascal. And even the actress that played my wife, Connie. I just forgot her name.
I had that up today, too. That's funny. I didn't even write that.
Christy.
something.
Oh, geez, I got to look it up. I'm going to be in trouble if I forget her name.
Don't worry, buddy. It's the best producer in the business. Will be in the chat room in just a second. Don't stress. But Connie Murphy, right?
Yeah, well, Connie's my wife, but yeah, the actress that played her was fantastic. Joanna Christie. There you go. Gosh, I can't believe it. You know, and she even came and spent a few days with my wife to learn more about her personality and everything. So it was really cool what we got to go through.
So now, before I get into how what the Pablo's, you know, last days, etc. Let me ask you this, Steve, because the chat room needs to know this, right? So when Connie was down there with you, right? Your luggage came back a little heavier from Colombia. Right? I mean, you came back with a couple of little people with you. Is that correct?
We did. And the Narco series shows that we adopted a little girl down there. The truth is we adopted two little girls. Monica was from Bogota. Basically, she was 8 months old when we got her. And Mandy is from Medellin. She was 5 months old when we got her. So they're 28 and 29 years old now, which is why I don't have any hair. If you have daughters, you know what I'm talking about.
You got two Colombian daughters. I mean, you know, seriously, you chase Pablo Escobar down. I mean, Wikipedia says you're credited with killing the biggest drug lord in Colombian history, making $500 million a week, $80 million a day. I mean, Steve, tell the people here. I mean, you got to get guys. Should you want to know the full story, what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to go and get Manhunters, guys. I'll tell you what, this book is amazing. This is a page turner. I mean, not just that, the pitches in here are worth buying this book alone, because these are some fantastic pictures for back then. You probably ain't gonna be able to see it on the feed, but you want to talk about some paper. There's some paper right there. Yeah, I mean, let me ask you this before I get into Pablo. How difficult is it to seize millions and millions and millions of dollars and to go ahead and put them into state's evidence, Steve? You tell me first, because I mean, that is something I would be fired from the DEA and I would be sleeping on a stack of money right now. I'd have to say my honesty would go out the window. How difficult is it to have all that money right in front of you, knowing that that's going into some, you know, closet somewhere, someone will probably skim it on its way there, etc.? How hard is that?
You know what? And I know people aren't going to believe this. It's not hard at all. You know, I grew up, we didn't have a lot. Blue collar family, basically. We worked for what we had. Didn't go hungry by any means, but, you know, my dad worked his butt off for us and my mom had to work. It comes down to the question of integrity and not to try to sound holier than thou. You know, that's not the point of this. But if that's a temptation, you need to go find another job, because you're going to see. We made one seizure in Miami, $14 million. I mean, it doesn't even look real. At that time when I probably had $8 in my pocket, you know, yeah. And it just wasn't tempting. It's, I think you look at it as a challenge, part of the game. And when you win, you just kick their ass because you took their money.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what, if I was coming on your show, Steve, right now, I'd be saying, Steve, you'll never believe it. This one seizure I did in Miami had $12 million. That's what I'd be telling you.
What happened to that other $2 million there? We got to talk. We got to talk.
Javier, tell me, how tough is it to go ahead? I mean, you're seizing gold bars. You're seizing money. I mean, on top of it all, everything you're around, we're talking just paintings. I mean, hippopotamuses. I mean, everything around you that you're seizing for Pablo Escobar. How difficult is it to go ahead and go, here's $20 million?
You know what? It wasn't the problem for us. You know what? We just wanted to seize as much as we could, because that's what really hurts the traffickers right now. When you take all their fancy toys, you take all their money away, you take their ranches away. You know, and Pablo Escobar was just so egotistical that all that, you know, the paintings he had, you know, multi-million dollar paintings. It was just to show off. The guy didn't know shit about art, but no. It's just this traffickers, and you'll see them in Mexico, Colombia. They show off to their friends all the riches. Look at his zoo in, you know, the famous Finca Napolis. He had a bullfighting ring. He had all the exotic animals. We know about all the hippos right now that have escaped. And yeah. I think there's about 100 roaming in Colombia right now. And you know what? It was just to show off, you know, the paintings he had, the boteros there hanging at the prison. And like we've alluded to that, you know, that prison was just a country club. That's all it was. But once you take that away, that's what hurts them. That's the only thing that'll hurt a trafficker.
And, you know, keep in mind too, Pat, we had a lot of friends that were Colombian National Police officers that were killed down there. There was one operation where eight of our, we worked with an elite group of police officers, and eight officers were killed in one operation. So, it, you know, it keeps your focus on what's important and what's, you know, what your job is, what your mission is.
I'm reading here. We have a great here in the chat room. It was stated in your bio, widely known picture of you holding the body of Pablo Escobar, and claims you were caught up in the moment. Is this true? And if possible, would you have done something different, Steve, at that time?
Yeah, it is true. And in fact, the book, there's the pictures in the book. You know, we don't shy away from this. So when Javier and I, this is our seventh year traveling around the world, we tell the story about Pablo Escobar. We use videos, the photographs that we took and all that. And we tell the true story. We present it as a lesson in history. As it turns out, I know you were leaving this as a cliffhanger, but I was not on the roof when Pablo was killed, as is depicted in Narcos.
Yep.
So that's Hollywood. I was back at the base. And the reason we like to point that out is because the true heroes of this thing are the Colombian National Police. They took their country back from this piece of crap.
Yep.
So the truth is, I rode out with Colonel Martinez after Pablo was dead, but I had the only camera that worked. There were other cameras out there, but none of them worked. So all the photographs that you see of Pablo's body, I took those. Now, the officers that were involved in that operation where he was killed, those are our pals. That's the guys that we've worked and lived with for the past 18 months. And so when I finally got up on the roof with Colonel Martinez, they're like, they couldn't say my name, Steve. It came out as Steak or Stick. So my nickname was Stick. They're like, Steak, take a picture. And they were posing and I was taking their pictures. And then they're like, come over here with us, get your picture made. And you do get caught up in the moment, because Pablo Escobar, the world's first narco terrorist, is dead. I mean, it was a moment of elation. It's a moment when you felt like the weight of the world was lifted off your shoulders. Connie's been back in Bogota for 18 months by herself. We adopted Monica. She's back there with our little baby girl. And I'm, you know, rarely getting to go back to Bogota to see her. So you took the picture. Now, when that picture hit DC, I caught a lot of grief over it, as you can imagine. You know, they weren't real happy about that. But, and it's honestly, it's not a picture that I'm particularly proud of now. You know, I mean, I know it don't sound like it, but I'm a Christian and I look back on it and I'm standing over a dead body smiling. And that's not what you're supposed to do as a Christian.
But it was something that, you know, like you said, a lot of your friends had been, you had friends that had died, you know, chasing them, trying to catch them, trying to apprehend them. And, you know, at the end, the search block seemed as though, you know, this was a victory, you know, that he was dead, because they didn't necessarily want to get him arrested, bring him back to prison, because the whole system in Colombia was basically, I mean, Pablo Escobar probably could have bought his way out of it again. I mean, it seemed like that was the goal. Am I far off, Steve, that the Colombian National Police wanted him not apprehended? They wanted him killed. Is that correct?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, over 1,000 police officers killed in one investigation. Wow. You know, we're all human. You have a mission and a responsibility. But when the guy's shooting at you, what other justification do you need? Yeah. He's got two 9mm pistols taken on the police, and they just tuned him up that day.
Yep. And now let me ask you this, Javier. Now, some people, when I was in Colombia, say that Pablo Escobar took his own life on that roof, put a ball through his ear. I guess they say he was definitely going to kill himself before he let the gringos kill him, etc. You tell me, big man. I mean, do you think that any of the folk legend here of Pablo Escobar, did Pablo Escobar take his own life on that roof? Or was it, as Wikipedia says, Steve Murphy, etc.? Who is it that you think actually, in the end, took Pablo Escobar out?
Steve Murphy definitely killed him. So
I should have said that about the girls. I'm sorry.
And you know, I'm going to let Steve, but you know, it was not a suicide. That, please, listeners, 100%, it was not a suicide. He was killed by the search block. Right. And you got to, and I think we've alluded to the search block, you know, bloque de búsqueda. They hated Pablo Escobar. They hated. So these guys were, you know, Colonel Martinez, who's a hero, who led the search on Pablo Escobar. Pablo was trying to kill Colonel Martinez's wife and kids. Yeah. He would write him letters. I'm going to kill your family. Here's where they're at. I mean, so it was a personal vendetta. And that's what I think kept us all alive and kept a lot of the cops from being on the take, because they wanted to see him dead. But, you know, Steve, you examined the body and it was not a suicide.
Yeah, because the legend says Pablo Escobar said if the you guys were going to get him, he was going to shoot himself right through the ear so he wasn't still alive and couldn't be brought back to the U.S. That's one of the things they said when they took us around and showed us the tour of beautiful Colombia and Comuna 13, etc. I mean, in the end, Javier, you stated more than once this was personal, correct? I mean, for you, yeah. Steve, and everybody else.
And this was very personal because of all the friends and good friends that were working side by side would be killed by Pablo Escobar. I saw about four of my good friends killed. So it was personal. And you know what? Colonel Martinez, who later on became a general, he would tell us point blank, Javier, Steve, we're not here to seize money. We're not here to seize dope. We're here to kill Pablo Escobar. So it was a revenge. And that's how Pablo Escobar in the end lost.
I got two last questions before we get to last call, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to hit it. Steve, they want to know if you know, what was the weapon used to kill Pablo Escobar? Do you know or remember what the weapon that was used to kill Pablo?
I just know what I read from the autopsy report. It was a 223 round, 5.52 millimeter round that killed him. He was hit three times, once in the back of the leg, once in the butt cheek, which are both knockdown shots, but neither were kill shots. The kill shot was a 223 round through the right ear. He's using 9mm.
Yep.
So, you know, if he's got 9mm, a 223 round is not going to fit in a 9mm chamber. The other thing is the pictures that you see online, we don't post those. People take pictures during our shows and they post them online. You can see close-ups of the side of the entry wound on the right side of his head with a kill shot. When you commit suicide, when you pull the trigger, there are bits of gunpowder that travel a certain distance until they lose their velocity and fall to the ground. There would be powder burns on the side of his head if that had been a suicide shot. Go look at the pictures and call me and tell me if you find the powder burns, because I haven't seen them yet.
Absolutely. And Javier has a great one. Throughout its mission, Search Block faced many obstacles, including spies within the group. There were claims that the Search Block collaborated with anti-Escobar vigilante groups such as Los Pepes, including vigilante in the suspicion of deaths for the Escobar's subordinates. Now, here's a question. When you were going ahead and you were going to be, you know, working with the National Police for Colombia, the spies within the group, it was highlighted on Narcos a lot that you didn't know if, you know, this was a spy, that was a spy for Pablo, this guy was on the take. Was that the biggest obstacle that you guys faced, knowing that the people you were talking to maybe going ahead and feeding this intel back to Pablo?
Yes, it was. And you know what? At the beginning, we had cops from Medellin, which we hadn't realized, and Pablo Escobar got to their families. And so he would tell the parents, hey, if your kid doesn't tell me when they're coming after me, I'm gonna kill your kid, and I'm gonna go kill you, the parents. So from there on, then we brought back we only used people from Bogota that were not from Medellin. That was one of them. But again, he had a lot of spies in our search block. And I remember one instance, we had a great operation plan. We knew he was there. It was about 10 houses in a lake area, Peñol, beautiful area of Medellin. And we were going to go out there. And when we raided the place, nobody was there. Pablo Escobar, we had a dirty cop, tipped him off. Later on, the informant, who was my informant, was killed by Escobar sicarios. They found out he was an informant. So at the beginning, he had a lot of spies and a lot of, so we, like I said, that's why we brought in specialized people that were not from Medellin.
Yep, understood. Now, Javier, give me one really great, because we talked about a lot of bad things that went on down in Colombia. Give me one really good memory from your time in Colombia, big man.
Great memory is the camaraderie we had with the cops. And you know what? Mm-hmm. You know what? The one of the best memories at nighttime, there was a little bar right outside the Medellin search block. It was called Candilejas, just a little wooden bar. Some of the best memories. We'd sit with the cops, have a burger, a couple of beers, talk about families. You know what? And later on, those guys would invite us to their houses, have dinner with them. And you know what? That to me is just one of the best memories, you know, that I have.
And that's something you'll take with you to the end. Steve, do me a favor, brother. I know, like you said, you adopted two beautiful young daughters, but tell me this, brother. Besides that, give me one really great memory that you have from your time in Colombia.
It was just the demise of Pablo Escobar. I mean, Javier and I knew we were working the case of a lifetime.
Yep.
You know, the fact that it was successful, even though we weren't the ones that carried it out, we just assisted the Colombian National Police down there. That's, you know, I mean, look what it's led to in our life after DEA.
Of course.
We're doing stuff now that we never dreamt we would do.
Right. Absolutely.
The real hero, and I got to do a shout out for Colonel Hugo Martinez, who recently passed a heart attack, later on became a general, and his son, Lieutenant Hugo Martinez. They're the ones who actually found Pablo Escobar. His father and son.
He's the one that caught it, right? He's the one who caught, intercepted, correct?
Was the one who DF'd him, and that's the famous raid that got Pablo Escobar killed. So it's a great story. Father, son at the search block, Colonel Hugo Martinez, and his son, Lieutenant Hugo Martinez.
And they took down the bad guy father-son team, Pablo talking to his son, Juan Pablo.
Yep, that's actually a good point. So father-son, take down father-son. That's an excellent point, Steve. I didn't even think of that ever until just now. Now, I was going to kick it over to last call, but before I do, I got to throw this one last one at you. If you had to do it all over again, not knowing the successful outcome, Javier, would you go ahead and do it?
Of course. We'd be there in a heartbeat. And you know what? And with us, it was all luck, basically, assigned the Pablo Escobar case. We didn't ask for it. It was just one of those things a lot of people know, just timing, you know. But I would, of course, do it again.
Love it. Steve, same question, big man. I mean, would you do it all over again, whether you knew or not this was going to be successful?
At that age, yes. At this age now, hell no. It's a young man's game.
I understand. That's fantastic. Ladies and gentlemen, we're having a blast. I could sit here all day with these guys. Should you guys make sure you got to give them some love, get over on Instagram, etc. Make sure you get the book, Manhunters. This is last call, everybody. Last call with Javier Pena and Steve Murphy is being brought to you by our friends at Clearwater Distillery. Clearwater Distillery is the official top shelf alcohol, the Happy Hour Social Club, and the most delicious small batch alcohol on planet Earth today. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 10% site-wide, and for the cheap folk, you spend over $100, we'll ship it to you for free. How you like those apples? Ladies and gents, it's last call. We are here with the DEA Narcos. Guys, they took down Pablo Escobar. Javier, it's last call, brother. Number one, should they want to go ahead and figure out where you guys are going to be and give you guys a follow on social media, if they want your book, etc., where can they find you? And do you got anything left for the Happy Hour Social Club members, big man?
Before I turn it over, Steve, he'll tell where he can find us. But again, thanks for inviting us here this evening. We appreciate it. And remember, when we do our tours, when we do our talk, it's the real history of Pablo Escobar. It's not the made up. It's not the Netflix story. It's the real history. We were there. We lived it. And it's part of history.
Absolutely. And like you said, I hope they don't erase all the history down in Colombia. I can't wait to go back and see a little bit more of it. Steve, I mean, I appreciate you guys being here, obviously, and everybody in the Happy Hour Social Club. Can't thank you enough, but do me a favor. You have anything left for the Happy Hour Social Club? And tell me this, if everybody wants to find you on social media, etc., website, where can they find you?
Check out our website, DEANarcos.com, DEANarcos.com. You can get autographed and personalized copies of our books there. International, go on eBay. We're on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, and LinkedIn at DEA Narcos. Check us out there. Check out our website. You'll see how great we think we are.
Absolutely, guys. And you know, as always, all the links will be in the show notes. So make sure you guys want to check out the website. All you got to do, check out the show notes, give it some love. And Steve, what, you have anything left for the Happy Hour Social Club members?
I do. We've got a true crime. We got a weekly true crime podcast. It's not as good as the Happy Hour, but check us out at Game of Crimes, gameofcrimespodcast.com.
And guys, I'm gonna tell Steve to have them tag me in an episode, and I'll make sure I put it on my story so you guys can follow their podcast as well. Guys, the book is called Manhunters, and should you guys want to get the real story of what happened with the Pablo Escobar search block, etc., right here, you can get it Barnes & Noble, you can get it on Amazon. I suggest getting it on audible.com or right from the website, because that'd be the best place. You can get a genuine Steve Murphy and Javier Pena autograph on that piece. Is that right, gentlemen?
Absolutely. And when we sign it, it becomes worthless. So come on over.
Well, the book has a great value. It's $29 value. Then Steve signs it and it goes to a goose egg, right?
That's right. That's it.
Guys, we're going to kick it out of here. I appreciate everybody tuning in. I appreciate all the great questions from the Happy Hour Social Club VIP chat room, guys. We'll be back live tomorrow night on the Lenny Melnick Fantasy Network, etc. Guys, do me a favor. HappyHourSocialClub.com. Should you want to get your hands on some new swag, Happy Hour Social Club on Instagram, Beantown Bad Boy on Instagram, etc., etc. We will see everybody. Do me a favor. Enjoy a little bit of Abyss version 2. We have to say goodnight. Javier, one last time, thank you. Steve, my man, thank you so much for coming. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Abyss version 2. We will see everybody next week. Take it easy.
Abyss, happy hour, happy hour. AbyssHipHop.com. Hey, sports fanatics applauding at the matches. Picking winners while we sift through the brackets. Yeah, turf green like a bag of sour. We gotta talk of that podcast. It's the happy hour. Meta come to the game fully geared. Who would dare? Been beast mode since the rookie years. Yeah, little fact of the lightning round. This is Title Town, the place where all of the fire's found. We attend games on the record. Heard more goals than a motivation seminar. Yeah, stay charged like a visa. So many bad calls, no, we stop by the Los bleachers. So click play and just soak it up. This is happy hour, but not the same as your local pub. Sports talk, hit the pro shows a must. Just go like the page, call the happy hour social club. Boss move, so you know your boy paid them dues. Front row, you can see us through the pay-per-view. Fights on, watching them box like big parcels of MMA. Know that the art is mixed martial. Listen, guests, you better play your best. You're playing fast, and better go take a breath and just play the bench. Yeah. Clap hard with these two hands.
You've been true fans, reading stats off the newsstand.